Hey listeners, welcome to the Fake News Podcast. Thanks so much for tuning in. On today's episode, we have our very own Karla Kaplan talking about inclusion and exclusion in religious communities with a focus on Asian Americans. Her piece was just published in the New York Times. So, to jump right in, how does inclusion as a member of a certain religion increase exclusion in other facets of one's life?
Well, during the Arabas Call 300 talk, he shared that leaders of other faiths have turned to him and asked him to use Ifa divination to help with their problems. He explained that he knows their preaching would be considered hypocritical if people knew they had ever turned to another faith. So I think for religious people, there's a lot of inclusion, like connections with people all over the world, inclusion in certain traditions and rituals and in certain holy spaces. But religious exploration outside of one's faith is very taboo. And by engaging in it, one really risks exclusion from their own religious community.
Do you think that same exclusion could also apply to religious people becoming less religious over time?
Yes, absolutely. Especially because religion, culture, ethnicity, and national identity are all so intertwined. I think many people who were raised within a certain religion and become less religious as they grow up risk exclusion from their communities and even from their families. There's actually a great episode of Aziz Ansari's Master of None called Religion that does a great job of exploring that. Ansari's character Dev was raised Muslim, but is not committed to Islam as an adult. When he orders pork at a restaurant, his mother gets very upset and threatens to leave. She doesn't talk to him for a while afterwards. So essentially the message she's sending is if he excludes Islam from his life, she'll exclude him from the family or from her respect or affection. Luckily, it all works out when Dev learns to compromise, and he accepts that it means a lot to his mother to show interest in Islam, even if he doesn't really practice it. But obviously, for some individuals, leaving a certain religion does mean permanent exclusion from their families and communities.
And do you think this exclusion can sometimes come from within rather than from one's family or community?
Yes, definitely. For example, Dev's cousin Naveed in the same episode was also raised Muslim and is a practicing Muslim in adulthood too. He believes in God, he prays, he gives to charity, but he drinks. When he confesses this, his guilt is very apparent. So even though he has decided that he would rather drink than follow every single teaching of Islam, he feels that because of this, he can't fully include himself in the religion. He doesn't really feel like he can just give a simple yes to the question of whether he's a practicing Muslim. So religious-based exclusion can absolutely come from within. Actually, funnily enough, we learn later that even Deb's parents don't follow all of the teachings of Islam. They adhere to their own interpretations, which really raises the question, I think, of how many people consistently follow every teaching of their religion. I assume the answer would be very few, if any, in which case this exclusion that people feel for straying from their religion in small ways actually is maybe what includes them in the majority.
So you said earlier that religious identity is very tied to cultural identity and national identity and so on. Could you talk a little more about that?
Yes, definitely. I think in Master of None, the conflict that I just described is not just about Islam, but also about Indian identity and transnational or immigrant identity. So for Dev's immigrant parents, all of these identities are being altered or really even lost in the following generation. So their son Dev is American-born, he has Western mannerisms, he's not religious. So his ties to all of these identities are one step removed from his own life. So I think that's part of why it's so difficult for his parents to see that he's not very committed to Islam, because every parent wants to feel that they have important things in common with their child. Actually, there's an article about the Korean-American community in U.S. Presbyterian churches that highlights how intertwined religion is with culture, national identity, and also language. It's easy to have this idealistic idea that religion is something that's beyond language or words, it's beyond borders, that it's accessible to anyone who wants to believe, but that has not been the experience of Korean-Americans in U.S. Presbyterian churches. There was actually a statement written by Koreans addressed to the larger Presbyterian community in which they urge for greater recognition and accommodations. It says, here's a quote from it, "Once with high spirits, they had looked upon this new environment of Christian love in which they could grow in grace and nurture their historical and rich cultural heritage. Instead, they have suffered the loss of selfhood and have been bewildered because of all forms of cultural and racial barriers." So racism is pervasive, even in places of worship, to the point where Korean believers felt that they had to defend themselves and their community within the larger Presbyterian community. There was actually also, there was this huge debate about whether to allow Presbyterian churches to speak Korean in their services or whether to promote English as a tool for denominational unity. Oh, obviously, preventing Korean-speaking spaces seems racist and seems like it would squash the religious expression of those who don't speak English. However, some second-generation Korean-Americans fought really hard for English to be promoted as sort of the Presbyterian language. They argued that specifically Korean spaces would limit Koreans to only having a voice in these spaces and exclude them from the larger Presbyterian community. They also argued that as Koreans who did not speak fluent Korean, they would be discriminated against in these churches. So their exclusion from the language would further exclude them from the religion. So religion, culture, language, and so on are all very much intertwined and sometimes almost inseparable.